Good morning, church. Good morning. Wow, that was awesome. Just a quick question. How many of you were at the Tim Tebow event this past Wednesday? How many of you got? Yeah, quite a few of us. You know, I got to, with Heath, your very own Heath Hatmaker, we got to be sports analysts for that night, which was really fun. And I just want you guys to know we sent our tapes into ESPN, so we're going to see. You know, we'll see what happens. Maybe they'll pick us up. Maybe they won't. What do you think our chances are, Heath? Slim? I thought you were going to say 100%. All right, well, I lost confidence now. No, it was a great time. So many decisions for Christ. Really, really great time to spend together with the community. And as you can see right behind me, we are starting a new mini-series in the book of Mark as we're walking through the book of Mark. And this mini-series is called Just Jesus, All Authority. And we're going to see over the next 4 weeks as we're leading up to our Christmas series, the authority that Jesus has over all things. Now, this isn't the type of earthly, incomplete authority that we see every single day. This isn't the authority that the boss has over an employee, or that the cop has over a citizen, or that the authority that a teacher has over a student, or even the authority that a parent has over a child. No, we are going to see an authority today and in the next couple of weeks that surpasses all of that. A supernatural, complete, and total authority unlike anything that has ever been seen before. And today we're going to see that very clearly in the text that we're in. It's the title of the message, Power Over Nature. Jesus' total authority and the power over nature. And we're going to be in Mark chapter 4. Verse 35 through 41, and why don't you go ahead and stand up to your feet as we read the word of God together. We're in Mark chapter 4, verse 35. It says this, on that day, when evening had come, he said to them, let us go across to the other side. And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. And other boats were with him, and a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boats so that the boat was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him, and they said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we thank you for your word. Thank you for the gift that your word is to us, that we can know more about you by opening this book and reading it and hearing from you, Lord. And so I pray right now, Lord, as we dive into the scripture, into your scripture, into your words, that we would know you more. That we would know you in a deeper way. Lord, give us wisdom and discernment as we go through your word together. God, this is a pretty familiar passage. And so I pray, Lord, for fresh new perspective into your word and fresh new application that we can take with us to transform our lives from the truth of your word. Lord, we love you. Thank you for this time together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You go ahead and have a seat. This is a pretty familiar passage. Raise your hand if you've ever read or heard or maybe studied through this passage before, that Jesus calms the storm. Yeah, so a lot of you have. And maybe as you were reading through it or studying it or hearing it, you heard or came to the conclusion about the main theme of this passage. And maybe you heard or came to the conclusion that the main theme of this passage, this scripture that we're going through today, is the main theme of faith or lack thereof in the disciples' case. But I'm going to propose to you today that the main theme of this scripture is not faith. Faith is certainly a theme, and it is a major theme in this scripture. But I believe that the main theme of this scripture that we are going through today is the theme of identity. It's a theme of identity, and more importantly, the identity of Jesus Christ. That's the main theme of this passage, and I'm going to show that to you as we walk through, and God's word's going to show that to us as we walk through it together. And so in the same way that Rian Johnson did with Star Wars, The Last Jedi, I'm going to try and subvert your expectation. I wasn't sure how that was going to land. It's good that three of you got that. I'm going to make a note. I'm going to make a note real fast. Don't tell Star Wars jokes. It's good. It's good for the three of you that did get that. I know that you're thinking, that movie was terrible, Pastor Tommy. I know. But hey, listen, I hope I do a little bit better. Here's the reality. Luke Skywalker's not dying at the end of my sermon. So it's better. Spoilers? Really? It's been out for a year. No. Let's discover this theme of identity in Christ, in God's word today. Let's jump into the text. We're going to be starting in verse 35. This is the first thing that we're going to see today, that the storm is part of his plan. The storm is part of his plan. Verse 35, on that day, when evening had come, this is a little context for us. All of chapter 4 is happening on the same day. So the message that we received last week from Pastor Dave Stone, that all is happening on the same day as this passage as well. On the same day, all of the teaching that Jesus was doing, all of the ministry that Jesus was doing this entire day, now evening has come. That gives us a better look into Jesus' day here. Those of you who have teached before, or those of you taught, those of you who have taught, those of you who have preached, those of you who have done a full day of ministry, you know exactly the type of energy that it takes to teach and to preach and do ministry all day. It takes a lot out of you. And so needless to say, Jesus had a very long day. A very long day. And he says, let us go across to the other side. Who said that? Who said, let us go across to the other side? Jesus. If you have a red letter Bible, that's cheating, okay? No, it's Jesus. But it's important that we know who said this. It's important. Who said, let us go across to the other side? It was Jesus. It was Jesus telling them that we have to go. We're going to leave. We're going to go right now over to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And you can tell this was done right away because of what the verse says next. It says that they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. That phrase there means there was no additional preparation happening. It was just as he was. Most likely, Jesus was still in the boat that he was in verse 1, teaching and preaching and doing ministry. And they took him right as he was in the boat. They just took him. No food, no need to change your clothes, no need to do anything else. We're leaving, we're going right now. Just as he was. Let us go across to the other side. And so they went. And as they were going, a great windstorm arose. And the waves were breaking into the boat so that the boat was already filling. This is a great windstorm. This is no ordinary storm. This was a dangerous storm. The word refers literally to a violent storm, a whirlwind, a tempest, a hurricane. That's the level of this storm. It was so intense that the waves were coming over the side of the boat, filling it with water, making it sink. And all the while, all this chaos is happening. This windstorm, this great wind is roaring, and the sea is churning. All while that's happening, Jesus is asleep. He's asleep in the back, in the stern, on a cushion. This is important on a couple of levels. It's important on a couple of levels. The first one is that it shows Jesus' humanity. It shows his humanity. You see, Jesus was 100% God. But Jesus was also 100% man. And Jesus was tired after such a long day of pouring himself out and doing ministry and teaching and preaching. Just like you and me get tired, Jesus gets tired. Isn't that great? Jesus can understand your weariness. He can understand your tiredness because he has also experienced that in his humanity. That's a great comfort. Shows Jesus' humanity. Here's the second thing. It shows that Jesus loves to sleep. That's right. If you love to sleep, you're like Jesus. I like to think about that before bed sometimes. You know, I'm thinking in a couple of minutes, I'm going to be asleep and it's going to be the best thing ever. Therefore, I'm becoming more like Christ. Here's the third thing. Jesus was a heavy sleeper. This crazy chaos is going on, Jesus is asleep. This is also another trait I share with him. Every morning that I wake up and my wife says to me, I hit you like 3 times last night to stop you from snoring. Did you even wake up? And I think to myself, no. No, I didn't. And in those moments, I feel really close to the Lord. Now, maybe you're taking notes and you're like, should I have written down those last two? I don't. Here's a serious one. He wasn't concerned with the storm. Why was Jesus sleeping? Because he wasn't concerned. He wasn't afraid. He wasn't anxious. He was at peace. You're not afraid of the things that you have complete and total control over. You're not. Jesus is not afraid. He is not anxious. He is not scared about this massive storm because he has complete and total control over it. You see, Jesus knew the storm was coming. He knew it was coming. He knew it when he said, "Let us go across to the other side." He knew that they would encounter this storm. This storm did not surprise Jesus. It did not catch him off guard. He knew that it was coming. Again, he's 100% God. He knows what the future holds. And so in a real sense, Jesus led his disciples into this storm. Because Jesus knows the future, and he knew it was going to happen, and he said, "Let us go across right now," he was leading them into this storm. He was leading them into it. He could have said, "Hey, hold on. Let's just hang out here for a little bit longer. There's going to be a storm that's coming across the Sea of Galilee. We're just going to let it pass, and then we'll get on the ship and we'll go." No, he said, "Let us go right now." Why? Because he was leading his disciples into a storm. He was leading them into a storm. And the truth is that God leads us into storms as well. He leads us into storms, trials, tribulations, crisis, trouble, those storms. The unfortunate diagnosis, the loss of a job, the pain of losing someone, the heartbreak of a wayward child, persecution, unjust treatment, pain, hardship, those storms. And here's the truth, is that the storms that you have faced in your life, God led you into them. And the storms that you will face in your future, God will lead you into those storms. This text isn't talking about what caused this storm. I think that that's important. This isn't displayed in the scripture for us. Was it God? Was it Satan? Was it sin? Was it the world? We don't know. The question of who caused the storm really isn't important for our time here today. What's important for us is knowing that God led us. God is leading the disciples into the storm, and he leads us into the storm as well. Because regardless of what caused it or who caused the storm, God knows about it. He knows that it's coming. You see, God exists outside of time. He sees eternity past, and he sees eternity future. And he could steer you and the disciples away from the storm, but he doesn't. He allows and leads us into the storm. Why? Why does God do that? It's because the storm is part of his plan. The storm is part of his plan. Now that might make some of you feel uncomfortable, and understandably, but let me encourage you. It's way better this way. It's way better this way. It is better that the storms are part of his plan. And I know what you're thinking, Pastor Tommy, how could that be any better? Knowing that we are being led into storms by God. That seems awful. That seems unloving. That seems unjust. That seems like God doesn't really care about me. That seems like maybe God wants me to suffer. No. Here's why it's better. I need a volunteer. Heath, can you come up here? Yeah, welcome Heath to the stage. Don't look at the screen. Just look at me. Don't look at the screen. Just look at me. Are you looking? Okay. Yeah, just look at me. Here, like right, can you stand right? Yeah, right there. Okay. And why don't you go ahead and just wave to some people out in the, you know, the.
I regret giving it up.
Heath, did you know that was going to happen?
No, I had a feeling, but no.
Mm-hmm. Were you surprised by it?
Yes.
Were you unprepared for that? I know that you've got some good hands, and so you seem pretty unprepared.
Yeah, you told me to wave at everyone.
Yeah, I did tell you. I did say that. That's pretty random, right? All right, let's try it again. Heath, I am going to throw this ball to you, okay? I'm not going to throw it very fast. Sorry, that first time was a little hard, okay? I'm not going to throw it very fast, but it is going to leave my hand. It is going to be in the air for a short amount of time, and then you're going to catch it with your hands, okay? All right, that's going to happen. Are you ready? Are you prepared now? Okay, here it comes. Ready? 1, 2, 3. That's for you. You can take that. Thank you. Thank you. What was the difference between those two things? The first time and the second time? Yeah. One of them was random, and one of them was planned. And those are very different things. Random versus planned. Random things, you're not prepared for them. It's a surprise. You're caught off guard. There's some unknowns happening. It's reactionary. And really, there's no purpose to it. It's just random. But when it's planned, you're prepared. Bless you. You're prepared. You're ready. The things are known. And it's purposed. And in God's case, his plans never fail. And so I, for one, am so glad that God has planned and is going to plan my storms, and that he isn't in heaven reacting and being caught off guard and being surprised by the random things that life throws my way. He plans it. He knows everything. He's prepared. And we're going to see that he not only leads us into these storms, but he leads us through them as well. And so what are some encouragements that we can get from these planned storms? What are the encouragements? I wrote down three things. The first thing is that he is in control. That's an encouragement. Because he plans it, he is in control. Because he has all authority, he is in control. Because he has all power, he is in control. That is an encouragement. Destiny is not in control. Fate is not in control. Karma is not in control. The God of the universe is in control of my storm. That's encouraging. Here's the second thing. He is with you. Someone tell me, where is Jesus in this story? Where is he? He's in the boat with the disciples. He's not far away. He's not far off. He is right there with them. And the truth is that in your storm, God is right there with you. He is with you. He is next to you. He is close. He is near. He is not ignorant to your pain. He is with you. That's an encouragement. Here's the third thing. He has a purpose. He has a purpose. Because it's planned, it has a purpose. The storms you go through have a purpose. God has planned them for you for a reason, for a purpose. Maybe it's to redirect your life. Maybe it's to increase your faith. Maybe it's to bring you to repentance. Maybe it's to sanctify you. Maybe it's to show his power to you. Maybe it's to remind you of who's actually in control. Maybe it's to equip you for the work of ministry. Whatever it is. Whatever it is, he has a purpose for your storm. He has a purpose for your trial, for your tribulation, for your hardship. He has a purpose for your pain. And we are going to see the purpose of this storm for the disciples that they went through here at the end of the passage. Here's the second thing that we see in the scripture. The second thing we see is that the storm needs his power. The storm needs his power. Look at the end of verse 38 with me. And they woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" You can really relate to the disciples in this moment, can't you? The storm has hit their boat. The water is filling up the boat. It is starting to sink. And they are probably trying everything that they can to make it stop. You see, six of the apostles were expert fishermen. They were veteran fishermen. They've sailed in storms before. They've sailed on this lake hundreds of times, I'm sure, through various conditions. They knew what to do and how to do it. But now, in this moment, and in this storm, everything that they try is failing. No matter how hard they work at it, no matter what they do, they are still sinking. And they are about to die. You can hear it in their voices. They say, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? We are perishing. We are dying." They were resolved. No amount of their own strength at this point can solve the problem that they're in. How many of us are exactly like that? I know I'm guilty of this. We are hit by a storm. We are starting to sink. And we try to do everything in our power to try and stop it, to get through it, to just hang on. I just need to try a little harder. I just need to push a little further. I just need to try something else. If I just keep going, something will change, right? And then when it doesn't, you start to fear. You start to get desperate. And right here at the end of themselves, the disciples look at the back of the boat and Jesus is sleeping. And you can hear the desperation, the fear in their voice. It's almost an accusation. "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Do you not care that we are about to die? Why aren't you helping us?" You know, this happened to my family less than a year ago. Right before Christmas, our son was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. The storm hit, and we were even less prepared than the expert fishermen were because we had no idea what to do. No clue. We had never experienced this disease. This was all new to us. Learning that our son would have this disease for the rest of his life, there's no cure. Hearing from the nurses that the complications that can come with it, like thyroid disorders and kidney damage and heart disease and neuropathy and blindness, other autoimmune diseases like celiac disease and Addison's disease, and the ever-looming, ever-present, nonstop, if we mess up a dosage of his insulin even one time and don't catch it, if we sleep through an urgent low one time and miss it, he will die. And I am ashamed to say that my first reaction was not to trust in the power of God. My first reaction was to trust in the power of myself. I can get through this. I can do it. If I just work hard enough, if I just keep at it, I can be the strength that my family needs. I can be the strength for my son. I can do it. I just have to try. I just have to go hard. Just have to work harder. I've got this. And then the first finger prick and insulin shot happened. And Zion was uncontrollable. Uncontrollable. Fighting with every ounce of strength that he had, screaming and crying at the top of his lungs, begging us to stop, saying, "Dad, stop it, don't do it again." And we had to do that dozens of times a day and multiple times during the night. He had to be pinned down by multiple nurses, and we would have to delicately stick him with a needle or suck up a small bead of blood from his finger. We stayed in the hospital for 3 very long days. And then we came home, and we went to the pharmacy, and we learned about the cost spike of insulin and the cost of equipment and medicine that we needed to keep our son healthy and alive. And I was afraid. I was desperate. How on earth are we going to do this now that we're home? How are we going to do it? How are we going to get through this? How can we possibly afford this? Why is this happening? God, why? How is this our life now? There isn't any light at the end of this tunnel. And I remain there for way longer than I want to admit. About a week and a half after we got home from the hospital, it was the night of January 1st. It was New Year's night. I finally pulled out my Bible. I didn't have it with me in the hospital. And we stayed home, and I didn't have it with me at home. It was at church. And so I got it, and I finally pulled it out. And I went to the verses that I have written down in the front of my Bible. And these are verses that are in the front of my Bible for peace and for comfort. And those verses are Psalm 55, 22. Cast your burdens on the Lord, for he will sustain you. He will never permit the righteous to be moved. Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. 1 Peter 5, 7. Casting all of your anxieties onto him because he cares for you. Psalms 29, 11, may the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. James 1, 2 through 4. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For the testing of your faith will produce steadfastness. And when steadfastness has its full effect, you may be complete and perfect, lacking in nothing. And then this, Mark 4. 35 through 41, the passage that we're in today. And then I prayed and I asked God, grant us strength. Help us to remain steadfast and give us peace in the midst of our storm. We'll get back to the end of that story in just a second. I want you to look at verse 39 with me in God's word. It says, and he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased and there was a great calm. You see, this is unlike any miracle that has been performed by Jesus before. This raging wind was probably in excess of 70 miles per hour. The waves churning were enough to overcome the boat. And by just speaking, the wind was gone. The sea was still. Thousands of pounds of force halted just by speaking. This is next level power. This is absolute power over nature. This is absolute authority over nature, over the storm. You see, the disciples, they didn't need to work harder. They didn't need to try harder. They didn't need to put their head down and keep pushing on in the storm. They needed the power that was in the back of the boat. The power that is only in Jesus Christ. The power to save them, to calm the storm, to get them through the trouble. It wasn't found in themselves. It was found in the back of the boat in Jesus Christ. Their storm needed his power. And your storm, my storm, needs his power. The day after January 1st, on January 2nd, I visited the pharmacy to pick up Zion's insulin for the next 30 days. And I was shocked at the counter and in awe when they said, that'll be $30. You see, 3 days before in 2018, when I went to the counter, they said, that'll be $350. Because it was $350 for each vial of insulin. And we needed two of them every single month. But we were having a baby the next year. And so before this storm ever hit, in God's providence and in his plan, our insurance changed. God calmed our financial storm. We were now paying 10% of what we would have before. God calmed it. That day, the same day I came home, we had the new insulin and I was giving Zion
his lunch shot. And I remember this like it was yesterday, because he didn't move. He didn't move. All he said was, ouch. He didn't cry. He didn't scream. He didn't fight. God calmed the storm. That week, I had multiple people in our church reach out to me who had kids with type 1 diabetes. And they gave us great encouragement and said, whatever you need, just ask. I had a pastor who also has type 1 diabetes come into my office that next week and tell me, whatever you need, any questions that you have, no matter the time of day, just call. We're here for you. We understand. God calmed the storm of isolation. And the reality is that it's still a struggle. It's still hard. But over the last year, the Lord has made us steadfast in him, unlike any year previous. Strength, steadfastness, peace, all of the things that I prayed on January 1st. He did. He held us. His power held us. So what do we do in a storm? What do we do? You may be going through a storm right now. It might be more fierce than the one that we've gone through. It might be less fierce. And maybe you've been trying so hard in your own power to power over the storm yourself, to push through it, to give it all of your strength, and nothing is working. You feel helpless. You feel defeated. You feel afraid. You feel desperate. Listen, the thing that you need is not found in yourself. The thing that you need is the power of Jesus to speak, peace, be still. It is not found in you. It is found in Jesus Christ. The power is not in you. It is in Christ. And so please, learn from my mistakes. Learn from the disciples' mistakes. Go to him right now. If you are in a storm, go to him. Don't do it another day in your own strength. Go to Jesus right now for the source of your power. Listen, there is nothing that we can do. Nothing. There is nothing that I can do in this situation to bring power to this situation. I've got no power. I've got nothing. I could try really hard. Nope. And when that fails, we're like, well, maybe I'll try something else. That didn't work either. Nothing that I can do. This is outside of my power. I have no power to bring to this situation whatsoever. The power generator in our lives is Jesus Christ. He is the generation of our power. He generates the power that we need to get through the storm. Okay. I felt it. There it is. He brings the power. And usually does it way faster than what just happened here. He's the one who brings power. I have nothing to do with this happening right here. The power being generated is not by me. The power being generated in the midst of a storm is through Jesus. It's through Jesus. Stop trying to do it in your own strength. Go to Jesus Christ. Here's the last thing that we're going to see in the passage, is that the storm reveals his person. Here's the main theme. It's right here. The storm reveals his person. Look at verse 40 with me. He said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Jesus asked some questions that reveal their lack of faith. Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? Haven't I shown you enough to trust me? You've been with me. You've seen the miracles that I've done. Have I not shown you enough to trust me? Have you still no faith? That is convicting, isn't it? How many times have I been there? How many times have you been there? Jesus has saved me from my sin. He has completely transformed my life. He has changed my eternity forever. But in the midst of a storm, I fear and lose faith. Just like the disciples, God, help us. Help us to trust in you. It goes on to say that they were filled with great fear. They went from being afraid to being filled with great fear. Why? Because this storm revealed who Jesus really was. This is a deep awe and amazement. They are starting to realize who is actually in the boat with them. The storm and the complete power and authority that Jesus has over it reveals to his disciples who he truly is. Who then is this? Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? They know. They know that the one who controls the sea and has power over the sea and the waves, that that's God. They know that. Who then is this? They called him teacher before, remember? They said, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Teacher. Wrong. God. He's not just a great teacher. He's not some great rabbi, just some great rabbi. He's not just a guy who loves to help people. He is Jesus, God incarnate. It's something so much more powerful. It's God. This is the main reason for this moment in Scripture. It's to reveal Jesus' identity as God. Who then is this? The one who has power over the sea and the winds. Who then is this? The one who can calm the raging storm, who can save us from death, who can bring peace to the chaos, the one who can rescue. Who then is this? This is Jesus, Son of God, all authority and power over the storm. This is Jesus, Son of God, all power and authority over nature. That's who this is. That's the main theme. This is Jesus, the Son of God, who has all authority. I love that question that the disciples say at the end. Who then is this? Who then is this? That question is a question that all of humanity will have to answer. Who then is this? It is the most important question of all time. One that each of us has to answer. You have to answer this. I have to answer this. Everyone who has lived before us has to answer this. And every person who will live after us will have to answer this question. Who then is this Jesus? The question determines everything. Determines my eternity. It determines my life now. Determines my purpose, my direction, my lifestyle. Everything wrapped into one question. Who then is this? I want us to answer this question right now. Who then is this? I want us to shout out the answer to this question. Who then is this? Who is Jesus to you? I'm going to ask some pastors to come forward and bring some mics to the front. And we're not going to put a limit on how many people come forward. This is the last service. We've got all the time in the world, don't we? We've got all day to answer this question. Who then is this? Who is Jesus to you? And so I want you to come forward. We're going to sing a song. And as the song is being played, I want you to just come forward to the microphones. And I want you to fill in the blank. Jesus is blank. It could be a word. It could be a phrase. It could be a couple of words. Who then is this? Come forward. Come answer the question. Come encourage those who are in this room. Tell them who Jesus is to you. So come now, right now, as we sing together.